Are you watching closely?
Well, I've got a bit of a situation here. I've hooked a bird. As soon as I threw this new Rapala lure out, it's one of the new Aussie special ones, it hooked up, and not to a fish, to a freaking bird. And this is going to be interesting. I really don't want to lose this lure, and I'm definitely having to let the bird go safely, so this is going to be a challenge.
Thankfully, this doesn't happen very often, and it absolutely sucks when it does. But on the light side, I guess you can take it that if the lure fools a bird, it'll definitely fool a fish.
Now I've got a real problem. The lure is hooked into the front skirt there. So we're going to have to deal with this thing. It's sitting on the bow. This is going to be a challenge.
Couldn't have made this any harder for myself. A good set of pliers comes in handy at times like these. Winters are relatively mild up here on the north coast of New South Wales. Don't let the sunshine fool you, it can get frightfully cold out in the water here, even for an ex-Victorian like myself.
We found a nice little patch of water here. Albie's just pulled up two beautiful fish. And this is my second fish here. Taking the Storm Thunderblade.
I've been catching some nice fish on these Storm Thunderblades.
Okay, let's throw out the Storm Thunderblade. See if we can get a hook up on it. They look like stripy tuna to me. Let's try that again. Stripey, and I just lost it.
But I've been losing my fair share as well.
Hooked up again here, this time on a large bucktail banjo, or a bucktail jig to be exact, from Williamson. And I think it's a pretty good fish I've got here.
Been hooking into quite a few fish with these Williamson banjo eye bucktail jigs as well.
Oh no. Come up again.
But I've been losing some of these too. This fish has managed to snag the line onto the bottom somehow. The last thing I want to do is lose another lure now. Softly, softly, catchy monkey. This morning's fishing started out a little anticlimactic at first, but it soon picked up.
We're off to a pretty good start here, mate. So that's number two for you. Yeah, that's a good size snapper. Yeah. Nice fish there, Steve.
Yeah.
Nice little broom's head snapper. Hooked up here. It's a pretty reasonable fish too. I'm going for snapper. It's midwinter. It's that time of year where the snapper come in here at Broom's Head. It's that time of year where me and a few other boys converge to the same area. I'm here today with Albie and Steve. They're a fair way out in the distance actually. They hit the water before I did. Okay. Let's see what we've got here. It's not huge, but it's a good fish. Coming in underneath the boat. Yeah, it's a good fish, all right. It's a nice snapper. Come here, buddy. Nice knobby-headed snapper. Lots of colour in it. Ooh, danger. Just right for the net. Had it been much bigger than that, I would have used a gaff. But no need. There's dinner. Nice big knobby headed snapper. Hooked while trawling on a repeller. X-wrap. Wow, look at that. It's got a hook hanging out of its mouth. Someone's hooked this fish before. Two nice fish too. Well done. Beautiful double hookup, was it?
One, and while I was dealing with one, the other one.
Yeah. Yeah. Nice work.
To do what we must, because we can. For the good of all of us, except the ones who are dead. But there's no sense crying over every mistake. You just keep on trying till you run out of cake. And the science gets done and you make a neat gun for the people who are still alive.
Each year, me and some mates go kayak camping up the sand and river. last winter was the first time using the cobb cooker. Cobb claimed that the Premier stainless model is perfect for use on a boat. So of course we thought we'd give it a try on a yak. That steam coming out of that strange dome lid at the back of my kayak is not a special effect.
Alright, we're on the way. The roast is also on the way. Have a look at that. Looks pretty damn good, doesn't it?
It worked out pretty well too. By the time we reached camp, a perfect dinner roast was ready to go. It worked out so well, in fact, that this year we took it with us again, but this time we got lazy and we cooked our roast once camp was set up. Here's how we did it.
So you can see here with the cobb, there is a moat there at the bottom, and you can see I've got some water in there, and I've got some leftover marinade that I've got the roast soaking in, and I'm gonna stick that into the moat, and that's gonna add some flavor. Righto, so that fuel tablet is well on the way there. It's quite hot now. Put on the hot plate. So we've got the beef on there. Hot plate is nice and hot. It's all go. It's just a matter of waiting for a little while now before we put the vegetables on. Okay, so we're about 25-30 minutes into the cooking of this roast. Off to a good start, and it's about time perhaps to put on some vegetables and spuds. So now I've got some vegetables there wedged in over the moat. I've got them wrapped up in foil and they will steam just above that moat nicely, soaking in all of the flavors from the herbs and the spices and the marinade. Go, I've got the spuds on. The roast is looking pretty good. It's really just a matter of waiting it out now. I'll put the lid back on. Been going now for nearly a couple of hours actually, and it's just about ready to go. We'll be eating pretty soon.
I've been experimenting with Ram Lightspeed rod holders since episode 2. It's turned into a bit of a love-hate relationship, to be honest. True to their name, releasing rods from the holder is a lightspeed process. The problem, as is the case with pretty much all ball socket mounted rod holders, is that it's difficult to secure them in place properly. This is especially bothersome when big fish strike, particularly double hookups. While they've done a great job of securing the rods under heavy strikes, they've not done a great job of securing the rod position. Under the weight of big aggressive fish like sharks and cobia, these holders will always get pulled out of position. Eventually I grew tired of this and decided to take matters into my own hands and come up with a better system for my style of fishing. So I came up with this. Cutting the base off these ram tubes in order to fully hollow them out, I then jammed them 2 inches deep into 50mm PVC pipe. Then I connected these together with a 50mm pipe spacer and two 45 degree PVC elbow joints, all glued together in the shape of a bullhorn. With the bullhorn bar fixed to the kayak at 2 points, the pivoting gravity issue is pretty much eliminated. Precious rods and reels can be leashed in numerous ways. I found this method works best for these holders. Secured into the reel seat groove with this method, the rod isn't just leashed to the yak, it's also held tightly into the holder. Because the ram tubes are hollowed and extend into a length of PVC pipe, they're long and deep enough to fit any rod up to its reel seat. This is a big advantage. Mounted directly behind the seat, the rod holder is always close at hand, and the trolling angles are pretty much perfect. It's nice and easy to fit, it's mounted at 2 points, and allows for a lot of variation in height position. Now that you've seen my swanky new rod holder system, allow me to introduce you to the rest of my kayak and its modifications. Before moving on, let's start with the real easy trailer that I used to cart the thing around. I grew tired of car topping my adventure island, so Rob from Real Easy Trailers came to the rescue. He's built many trailers for kayaks and especially adventure islands. This model here, the Barku, is a prototype. I love it, and it's easy to see why. I can load and unload the yak almost fully rigged, sliding it on and off without having to disassemble the yakas or armors. Easy peasy lemon squeezy. These are what I use for storage of inactive rods. I don't often use them for fishing, but they're a great way to secure rods that you're not using at the time. Bungee leashes work well on these, as do coiled leashes. Let's have a closer look at my rear storage well. Here I've rearranged the bungee lines and added snap clips to better accommodate the various gear that I carry. The Terminator 100 wheel cart, built by Taztec Industries, toughest kayak cart going. These waterproof and crush-proof boxes carry my safety and tackle gear. I'll go into more details on their contents next episode. My kayak is fitted with spray skirts. I've customized these with a dynamic tensioning system that makes it simple to pull them tight and loosen them off. I use a jam cleat to release and restore tension to the starboard skirt. Not only do the double bungees secure the armors better and minimize potential failure, this system provides backups in case it does happen. After having an armor bungee cord fail on me while on expedition once, I came up with this system to stop it from ever happening again. All AI owners will be familiar with the starboard cleat used to pull the rudder down. But to go along with the new 2011 rudder, I've installed the same style of cleat to the port side upline. This aids smooth control of the dynamic rudder. Hobie's new island rudder system really is great. It's smoother, it's much more responsive, and offers utility in all positions. It can be deployed at specific heights, making it more versatile for sailing, paddling, or for shallow water. I've secured the inner side of the tram to the gunwale of the hull via a swivel snap clip with locking pin. This provides additional tension on the tramp and minimises undersplash on deck. I use the tramps to carry all sorts of things, from camping cargo to net, paddle and sometimes even fish. It makes sense to use a single bladed T-grip paddle with an AI fitted with a single tramp. The Carlisle T-paddle is strong enough to safely do this. I've even used it to dig my car out of a bog. For navigation, I use a Lawrence GPS mounted to the kayak with a RAM C2B variable swivel arm. GPSs can run out of batteries though, so I also have a compass mounted. I use a custom Mirage Drive pedal arm with multiple pedal positions for alternative gearing perspectives. My GoPro cam is mounted with a quick release B2B variable swivel arm. This cam is responsible for most of the full frontal footage I capture. Footage like this of my previous gaff hooks getting raped. This shark killed my X-Tool gaff, and this one humbled my backup, so I got my good mate Rob from Real Easy Trailers to build one out of stainless steel, which I then adorned with end caps and cord wrap handle. As far as kayak seats goes, the best I've ever found is the Hobie kayak seat itself. For extra comfort and a higher, drier ride, I found it helps to add an Impy 3M glue-on seat pad. Skipper seat experiment. The skipper seat is a padded folding seat that fits neatly into the hull of the AI. Using Fastex clips at the front of it, I've got quick release access to storage underneath. Here I've stored a towel, ropes and anchor lines. I've attached it to the rear with turnbuckles fixed to the inside storage well. The turnbuckles give me fine adjustment control of its position at the back. The backrest folds up and down, so if I need to access anything at the back, it's pretty easy for me to get to it. I've definitely found this to be a more comfortable, higher and drier ride, and especially good for sailing. It turns out that it's also pretty good for pedaling. The question is, what's it like for fishing? Let's find out, eh?
I don't know what I've got here, but I'm going to go for Trevally. Actually, it's taken a Rapala Extreme Action X-Wrap Slash Bait in olive colour. caught a lot of fish in this colour and Rapala lures. I've caught a lot of trevally just here, so that's all I think I've got. The water's pretty murky, so I can't see anything at the moment. Up she comes, yep, it's a trevally. Not terribly big. There we go, back. Slippery little sucker.